Lioba, you've been working in the broad field of rural development, food and nutrition security, and gender for more than 20 years now. You must have seen quite a number of new ideas in development aid coming and going. Currently, everybody in international cooperation speaks about the forming or influencing of the post-2015 agenda. Is this just another fashion, or what makes this current discussion so outstandingly different and important? What's at stake here, not only for the poor people out there, but also for the system of development aid cooperation as we knew it?
In my understanding, we are really at a turning point now. After many years of working in achieving the Millennium Development Goals on hunger and malnutrition reduction, we are coming to the point where the 2015 development goals are achieved or are not achieved. And we see that the hunger reduction goals are one of the most challenging goals. If we achieve them, we may achieve them, we still have more than 800 million people living in hunger, malnutrition, and rural poverty, mostly rural poverty. So we achieved quite something, but we need more achievements.
In practical terms, how could that inclusion of nutrition be done?
We have a number of initiatives at various levels, government, civil societies working on achieving food and nutrition security. We know that we have a number of cost-effective food and nutrition-specific interventions, and we also have activities that make the sector work in agriculture, in health, in education, social safety net more nutrition-sensitive. So we need commitment at national level, and we need to bring this political commitment to rural areas and to poor urban areas where most of the malnourished population still lives.
We have a situation where everybody talks on the one hand about that things are connected and interdependent, that we have a nexus here and there. But still, on the other hand, everybody tries to push their particular subject that they are interested in into the process. You are now very much interested in nutrition. Now, why do you think nutrition is so important that it needs to be reflected in the process?
Good nutrition is a precondition and a complementary factor to good health, so that people can live to their economic, social, and cultural potential and contribute to developing societies. On the other hand, lack of good nutrition entails huge economic, social, cultural costs. So it's not only a human imperative, but it's also a good thing to do from the economic point of view, and last but not least, it's also a human right. So a focus on nutrition, for example, on stunting as one of the indicators in the post-2015 agenda as a sustainable development goal, is a very good way of measuring progress towards human development in a sustainable manner.
There's a whole number of processes, and for the sake of this interview, you've provided a whole list here for us to look at. Which of these processes is the most important one, and why?
Currently, there is the intergovernmental process of negotiating sustainable development goals, SDGs, in the context of the work of the Open Working Group on Sustainable Development. This group was created after the Rio Plus 20 conference, and this group has to submit a report by September with a proposal for specific Sustainable Development Goals. Once we are in September, the international community will continue to discuss about a new development agenda. So there is a follow-up process that will be equally important as the formulation of the Sustainable Development Goals to lead to a negotiated post-2015 development agenda that is expected to integrate the Sustainable Development Goals. And then, of course, once we have this new agenda and the specific Sustainable Development Goals, we have to implement programs, policies, strategies that help to achieve these new goals.
So what is the biggest challenge in terms of the process?
We have a number, very many proposals for specific development goals, and we have too many. The biggest challenge now is to come to goals that are specific, that can be measurable, that are within a time frame reachable so that people can really join forces to work for that. And then we have the political dimension of agreeing on a set of specific goals. And this will be a very hard work to be done at the level of the Open Working Group until September, integrating perspectives of government, of civil society, of people affected by poverty and malnutrition, food insecurity, and also integrating research results. So a multi-stakeholder, multi-sector approach is needed in order to achieve food and nutrition security goals.
So we are here now with the Global Donor Platform for Rural Development, and we have 37 members. They're all concerned with rural development issues, obviously, and nutrition-related areas are certainly to some degree of their interest as well. Where do you see a good role for those members to come in and push the process?
I see a very important role for the donor platform, because bringing the experience of so many stakeholders together, working in the field of agriculture, rural development, and sectors that are linked to nutrition, including nutrition work itself at the level of the platform, is a very important input into the intergovernmental process of formulating. So getting the SDG right needs this input of experienced people and policy processes. The Global Donor Platform works on it, and I encourage to contribute to meaningful sustainable development goals and a meaningful post-2015 development agenda in order to make food and nutrition security a reality.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. All the best.